Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Good morning. Still,
yes, we still have lunch
no,
ahead.
It's after 12. Those of
you know, this was not easy to be a coordinator with her.
Yes, yes. But at the end, we agreed that we are very happy to be here. Anyhow, it is very difficult to be not passionate when you are being asked to speak about your beloved child, and the housing partnership is our beloved child. But to be also practical and to give the information, we have to come to the history and we have to repeat what was said this morning. First, housing is home. Housing is not a good. Housing is not a brick of gold. And second, we all care for housing. So when the partnerships were created, or the idea of partnerships was created, we met several representatives of several institutions, national governments, city governments, housing providers, representatives of tenants, in a very lucky combination. So it was not that issue of affordable housing arose then. No, there were different long years ways of different people and different institutions fighting for different aspects of housing, but luckily meeting under the umbrella of Urban Agenda for the EU, of housing partnership, a pilot partnership in this exercise, to join forces and to try to put what we were maybe not able alone to put through, to put it through now together. So this was the beginning, Michaela.
Okay, so I would like to have control over the slides. Is that okay? I love to have control. Those who know me, thanks. Good. So thank you. And I'm very, very happy to be here and very proud that the final conference of our 3 years work now takes place in my hometown, beautiful Vienna. I'm really happy about that. So Elena reminded you that what we did three years now is part of what we call the EU Urban Agenda, and that there's been a warm partnership assigned to the issue of housing. And this is just to recall you what our task was in fact given to us by the Pact of Amsterdam. So this is a legal document adopted by the Council of the EU, and it says the task of our partnership is to have affordable housing of good quality. The focus will be on public affordable housing, state aid rules, and general housing policy. And the task is also described further, meaning that each partnership will have to formulate an action plan with concrete proposals for better regulation, better funding, and better knowledge. And I can tell you that we have the action plan. It's here. Yeah. This is signed by all the members of my dear partnership, including the mayor. I stole a signature from him. And in fact, we took this task very serious, and this is why we continued to work a lot. This is one of our meetings, as you can see. And what we did, and Elena told you that we have a lot of members coming from different backgrounds, cities, member states, housing providers, tenants organizations, European Commission, EIB, and of course experts, which we're very lucky to have with us in this 3 years journey. But what I want to show is that we really, in our partnership composition, reflect a great variety of experiences, of traditions, of the whole and really rich pattern and the fabric of housing solution the European model has developed in its history. So we are really proud that we really reflect a whole variety and difference, a variation of systems and housing traditions. And this made us, I think, also very strong on the expert level. Elena.
That's right. We started with a brainstorm because it really, what happens depends on who are the participants. I am sure that the outcomes of this partnership might have been different if we were different. We were not different. We came with our expertise, with our missions, with our expectations. This is how we started formulating what is the most important for every and each of us. And if you would see, which is not possible because it's small, on the blue paper on the left-hand side, it sees that one of the our mission was to contribute to world peace. It sounds like a terrible cliché, But as a matter of fact, if we seriously think about it deeply and without any prejudices, providing affordable homes, it really contributes to world peace. Because if people have a place to live in dignity, they don't need to fight for elementary things.
Yeah, that's right. So I hope the United Nations appreciate this as well. No, and just to be also a little bit more serious on that, we know that our work as a housing partnership also contributes to a great extent to what the United Nations have formulated in their sustainable development goals, especially the goal number one, that is all about cities. And we also contribute to the new urban agenda as decided by the Habitat Conference. So we really believe that what we are doing here on a European scale can also be uplifted to the United Nations and the global level.
Maybe to add, our main tasks as delegated by the Amsterdam Pact was to come with the proposals for better regulation, for better financing and better knowledge. And as we agreed that what we are going to do is to concentrate on certain part of this housing continuum as described this morning by Orna, we had to agree what we are going to concentrate at, because one of the dangers of housing is that it's too complex. It covers everything starting from social through environmental, through cultural to economic. And we had to really pick certain things we dared to tackle in this 3 years' time to come with some really practical conclusions. So this was our focus on affordable housing in this context.
Yeah, and of course we also had to identify, like Elena said, it's very complex, there's a lot of issues. You will have, when you start such a housing partnership, you will have architects calling you, urban developers calling you, different interest groups calling you. So what you have to do is to really try to find what are the priority themes that you can deal with in 3 years of time. And with the composition you have in a partnership. So what we in fact did, we came back to the task that was assigned to us in the Pact of Amsterdam and said, okay, let's talk about competition law. Let's talk about the definition of services of general economic interest. Let's talk about instruments and for investments, for loans, for financing conditions. What do we need as cities? And also let's talk, of course, about the top issues that we all in cities have to tackle with and have to find solutions for, which is, of course, the protection of vulnerable groups, the anti-speculation, the renovation and energy efficiency, the co-management and co-design, the spatial planning, the rent stabilization, the land use, which is super important for the question of how cheap or how expensive your construction will be, and of course, the security of tenancy. So these were our topics we have been choosing at a very early stage of the partnership.
Unfortunately, we will have more time in the afternoon panel to go to the details of these individual parts of our work. But as a matter of fact, what we really try to do and to really use the first time actually historical possibility of cities, commission, countries, other players to be around the round table on the really equal footing. And this is, I would say this is a unique experience in policy making in Europe. And as it sounded this morning several times, housing is not EU competence. Neither urban development is European competence. It is up to the states to create the framework conditions for cities where the things happen, that these conditions are ideal. But because it is not a EU competence, there is also very little intergovernmental and interpartnership floors, formal floors, where we could exchange on how to do it in the best and perfect way. So we were trying to contribute to this dispute and also to creation of the good conditions for this exchange of knowledge and opinions and solutions and inspiration.
And concretely, we did this, for instance, in the picture you can see, we organized with the help of the Committee of the Regions a workshop at the Committee of the Regions on state aid, because we thought that we have delivered a very, very thorough analysis about how state aid rules do affect, in fact, housing investment in cities and regions throughout Europe. And we know all that there is a lot of problems around it, that this can be very different in new and old member states. We did a thorough analysis about that. But we thought that after talking for years now already with DG Competition, we should invite them to do in a multi-level, multi-stakeholder exercise, a workshop together to clarify a little bit what this is all about. And this is in fact the picture where we organized this workshop with high-level experts on state aid together with housing practitioners. And this was part of our set of actions on state aid, right? Yeah, so I have to switch.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the better regulation work strength concentrates on state aid. Then we worked also with studies.
Yes, during the discussions, the initiating discussions, we actually found that obvious thing, that the housing policies really differ across Europe. They are linked to the traditions, to economic performance, to historical relationships. And there was one really very, very visible difference, which was between the new member states of the EU and the old member states. While the old member states traditionally had certain well-developed policies with good instruments and good legal framework, this was not always the case in our countries. And this morning I was really struck by the repeated focus on affordability of housing and on the role of what municipal housing, social housing, affordable housing with public intervention means for social cohesion. And what happened in other countries in the new member state, because I come from Slovakia, maybe in beginning of 90s, we had a very comparable composition of 10 years in our housing stock as the old member states. There was a lot of really public intervention into housing to make it affordable for population. And then this really neoliberal paradigm influenced in very quick period what was happening and what then should happen in our countries, because we privatized. We privatized to such a level that momentarily most of our countries are the biggest housing owners across the world. We have 90, 95, 97% of ownership. But this was privatized to people with the really the scale of income as it usually is in the society. So actually many people who can't afford economically to be owners became owners. So we had actually to analyze the situation at the beginning of our work as a partnership to see the differences and to pick the core, I would say, threatening elements in this situation. And therefore we started with two studies describing actually possibility to finance affordable housing in these two kinds of different settings across Europe.
Yeah, and we found out, of course, a lot of differences, especially, for instance, when it also comes to financing. Financing affordable housing is, of course, something which you basically, you finance it from on the local level, on the sub-national level. Most of the public investment, we know that, are done on the sub-national level. However, we know that EIB funding, EIB financial instrument and cohesion policies can contribute to that as well. We, for instance, learned in our financial, say, work strand that the uptake for EIB financing instruments was much higher in the old member states than in the new member states. Example, in the last 10 years, of all the EIB loans given and granted for housing, 35% went to the UK. Which means that the UK people will now have to pay back, of course, the loans, which they received still after Brexit. But this is another comment I allow myself. In the end, we know that the uptake for funding from EIB and for financial instruments from the EU depends very much on, do you have aggregators? Do you have structures in your city, in your country, that allow you to take that money and to even combine it with other sources of finances? And let us not forget that the biggest share of the financing is coming from the users. So it's not only about the institutions, the financial institutions, it also is about the users who are financing all of that, what's happening. So we are talking a lot about more capacity building for cities in the uptake of funding. This is something we found out as a very, very important issue.
Also we found this indirect relationship between how macroeconomically the situation in the countries is judged, let's say European semester, with all these macroeconomic recommendations for the countries, which then the countries have to translate into individual actions. And usually, this is about savings of public spending on the balanced budget. And then the issue comes, where can we make the cuts on the national level? And usually the most vulnerable topics suffer most, and housing is very often among these. So this was again one of the findings we really had to underline also vis-a-vis the state aid rules. And I have to stress this very much, because this morning it was very clear that the development of urban development is very dynamic. But the state aid rules and other formal regulations of EU are rather static. They were created in certain time, certain development time, certain economic circumstances. And they don't reflect, they don't provide anymore a really fair framework for solving our recent problems, which are so different from those 30 years ago.
This means that we have also tackled the European semester and looked for interpretation, more method, more means to use it in a way that we can finance affordable housing in the current framework. But of course, there still is, and it was mentioned by the mayor before, there is a need for a golden rule in order to say deblocking public investment in cities, in long-term needed infrastructure is something that we need to continue talking about. So what we also, I mean, this is an example of something we did, and you can look at it on the web. We developed together, and under the leadership of our member Housing Europe, we developed a toolkit, which should be like a very practical database. And I just give this for interesting and inspiring housing projects. And I just give you this as an example that we worked a lot, because we shouldn't get too long now, about the necessity to have more exchange opportunities for cities, especially when it comes to find out what they can be done about housing policies and housing projects.
Exactly. So we won't go to the details, but we actually addressed the need for better exchange of existing good examples and maybe also bad examples and bad experiences on a national, on a local, and on an expert level.
Yes, let's keep it like this. And what we really want to say is that we have also developed a good set of recommendations on good housing policy. Now, this was very important because it was also one of the tasks we were assigned by the Pact of Amsterdam. And we thought it would be really practical to have something like a toolbox out of which a city, a region, a country, and even the EU can take the instruments we propose on several top issues that are relevant to urban housing policy. And this was, of course, inspired by our other big stakeholder member, the International Union of Tenants. And because they worked a lot on, for instance, the security of tenancy and the rent regulation and the need for having indefinite rental contracts, for instance, in order to create a level playing field with people who own an apartment, because their contract is in fact indefinite. So why shouldn't the tenant have the same right in the market? I just leave it like that. All of this is published already by today now on our website. And you can read the full action plan at the moment, I'm sorry, only in English. We'll have translations of short versions quite soon, but we will also hoping for having translations into all EU languages also at a later stage, I think about March, February next year.
Please. But definitely it's going to be ready before the elections to the European Parliament. And we are sure that we are going now really to promote the work and the messages to all who might be interested to bring it from this expert level to political level. Because unless it becomes a sort of policy priority, as it was stressed this morning several times, unfortunately, we, those who believe in importance, we will still believe in the importance, but not so much is going to change. And we hope that there is going to be some change. Thank you.
Okay. And just a last, because this presentation contains product placement. So I just like to address your attention to Erin, we have endorsed, of course, also a good practice as part of what the things we are recommending to people. And this is something you can do right away. If you're a housing association, if you're a housing cooperative, if whatever, if you deal with social housing or affordable housing as a company, please go to Erin, the European Responsible Housing Initiative, which is also led by several of our members, IUT, Housing Europe, and which has been signed recently by the city of Vienna, of course. So just go for that as well. Thank you very much for your attention.